I want to talk to you today about how to architect the utility scale quantum computer. And the first thing I want you to keep in mind is that while over the last millennia technology has advanced computing, it has not fundamentally changed the way we compute. And in fact, the abacus that was invented 4,500 years ago works fundamentally on the same principle as the fastest of today's GPUs. But that is changing with quantum computers. The qubit works on fundamentally different ways and we compute differently. Does that mean we have to relearn everything about computing? Fortunately not, because the systems we'll build will be similar. Quantum computers will come in as just another type of computational accelerator. When I was in high school, we got floating point units, FPUs. Later, we got GPUs, FPGA accelerators, and now we'll get one new type, the quantum accelerator. And the way we'll build them will be quite similar to the accelerators we built in the past. Fortunately, there's lots we can just reuse. First of all, quantum computers will be accessed via the cloud. And that's why I can just take the architecture of a cloud data center from the workloads down to the hardware. And when I look at the stack there, then these are on top the the workloads helped by Copilot, running on many different types of machines. In Azure, we have, for example, the D-series queue for general purpose compute. We have the H-series for supercomputing applications. We have the N-series for GPUs. We have machines with large memory in the M-series and many, many more. And now we'll bring in one more type of SKU for quantum. And the same is true for any data center, any on-prem installation, any supercomputer center. They're always on top of the workloads. Then they're always the same developer tools and then just the local compute services, the data center systems, and then various types of clusters. A modern supercomputing center may have some high throughput clusters, some high performance machines, large memory machines, GPU clusters, and more. And we'll add in one more type of machine, the quantum computer. We don't actually have to add it in because the input and output of the quantum computer, as we discussed in the first episode, is limited compared to a classical one. And quantum execution will take minutes and hours and days for program execution. That means the quantum computer doesn't have to be in the data center. It can actually be thousands of miles the way it can be anywhere on the planet and just connected by a network link. So now that we've seen how a quantum computer can fit into a data center, I want to talk more about the architecture of the quantum computer. But before I go into that, I want to talk through how a quantum program gets written and runs on the qubits. For that, I want to walk you through all the steps from the application through various intermediate representation to a quantum executable, the logical qubit operations, the physical qubit operations, down to the control signals that are then sent to the qubits. The example I want to use is teleport. It's arguably one of the simplest quantum application where I just move in the state of one qubit to another qubit. And I show the quantum circuit on the right, and on the left I show that program written in a programming language, Q-sharp. And this is a sequence of classical and quantum instructions. The first step after the writing the program is to compile it. The compiler takes that code and translates the high-level code into a sequence of lower-level instructions In this case, in the so-called quantum intermediate representation. But it not only translates the code, it also optimizes the code. For example, here you teleport, first to the Hadamard gate followed by a CNOT gate. And the compiler recognizes that what the user actually intends is to prepare Bell state, so replaces that by the Bell state preparation instruction. Next, it sees that there's a Hadamard gate followed by a measurement, and the compiler realizes that can be optimized by replacing it by an X measurement, and it does that. There are also the classic instructions in their classical branches of an if statement, classical computation, and more. So once the code is compiled, it is sent to the quantum machine. And there's one more compilation step happening first. Now the code is being sent to the quantum computer. And there the code is now optimized once more for the specific machine present. One example is a CNOT gate. Depending on the type of machine, I may be able to do a CNOT gate between any pair of qubits or only between two neighboring ones. Let's say I want to do a CNOT gate between data qubits 0 and 1. I can just do that operation. But what if I want to do a CNOT gate between qubits 0 and 2 on a machine that only lets me do gates between two neighboring qubits? In this case, I cannot simply do the CNOT gate, but I have to first move one qubit close to another and then do the gate. So in this case, I can do that by applying a swap operation. I swap qubit 1 and 2, and now qubit 2 has been moved to next to qubit 0. Now I can just simply apply the CNOT gate. So in optimizing and translating the code to an executable for a specific machine, I may do the optimizations for that machine, but may also have to insert the data movement statements and more to make the code work on that machine. Once that is done, then I run my code. The classic instructions run on the classical CPU, and the quantum instructions are sent down into what we call the quantum engine. But not all quantum instructions might work natively on the logical qubits. Depending on the quantum error correcting code, the set of operations is different. So now the next step is translating the instructions like CNOT to the specific operations available on the logical qubits. For example, here where we assume a so-called cold surface code, doing a CNOT gate requires four steps of measurements on three qubits in total. So I need one more qubit, the ancillary A0, and then I do a measurement there, I do an x-axis measurement between the ancillary and qubit 1, then I do a CC measurement between qubit 0 and the ancillary, and then I finally do an x measurement on the ancillary, and effectively that has performed the CNOT operation. This mapping is the same as the mapping that happens in a classical CPU that translates the instruction that comes into the microcode. The next step then is, as you know, a logical qubit consists of many physical qubits, and thus a logical qubit operation has to be mapped to a sequence of many measurements on many qubits. And I just go through the sequence over and over while the qubit idles, and I modify the sequence a bit to do operations. The final step then is that every one of those physical operations has to be sent to the physical qubit, and so I have to send the right control pulses down to the right wires to the qubit to execute that gate operation. And with that in mind, let us now go back to the architecture. we have now seen how the code flows from the high-level source code down to the control signals to the qubits. And actually, most of the stack is the same as for classical computers. I write my program in the high-level language. I compile it to an intermediate representation. I then run it through a backend compiler that makes the executable optimized for a specific machine. When I run it, the instructions are sent to the CPU, where they are converted to the microcode that is then actually executed. It's basically the same stack for a quantum computer. And that makes building it easier. So let's now go back here and see how do we actually architect the quantum computer. We've seen that at the cloud data center level, the architecture is the same, be it a classical or a quantum machine that I put in. When I look at that quantum computer, then let me now walk you through the architecture stack of the quantum computer. On top, there are the workloads, hybrid applications, quantum, classical code, AI, GPU, CPU code, all combined together to solve a certain problem. Quantum computers will not work by themselves. They will always work together with classical computers. I write the code using the standard developer tools we have. GitHub, Visual Studio Code. I have quantum compilers that work just like classical ones. And more we'll start writing code with AI. And vibe coding works not only for classical code, but also for quantum. So my bet is that by the time when we'll have a scaled quantum computer, we will be programming most quantum computers just the natural language using tools like Copilot and agents. The code is then still compiled and optimized for a certain machine, and then is sent down to the quantum accelerator that runs a quantum operating system and has quantum drivers to control the qubits. The quantum operating system is first used to set up and configure the quantum accelerator. It is used to compile the quantum program for a specific machine. And this is then used to execute the quantum and classical program. And the classical parts of the program run on a classical CPU on classical hardware in the machine. The quantum instructions are sent by the quantum driver down to what we call the quantum engine. And the quantum engine really controls the qubit and runs all of the quantum instructions. When I boot up the quantum computer, first the quantum engine, though, is responsible for calibrating and tuning and testing my qubits. Once it's working, once it's passed the power and self-test phase of the classical computer, like once you hear the nice chime you're waiting for, then you're ready to run the quantum instructions. And that's where, as discussed before, the quantum instructions are first translated into the quantum operations of my logical qubits, and then from the logical qubit operations to the physical operations. And that's done in a system that we call the qubit virtualization system that translates from logical to physical qubits. And then it's further converted to the control sequences that are being sent down to the qubits. And the qubits are then at the bottom of the stack, the fundamental and most important part that makes it a bit different than a classical computer. So now we've seen the stack and I've walked you through the flow from the workloads down to the hardware and how by using the architecture that we know and that we've optimized over decades for classical computers, we have a very clear path of building the system for a utility scale quantum computer. And I just cannot wait to have one. Thank you.